Test, test, 1, 2, 3. Thank you.
Thank you. brothers and sisters, welcome to Brian Buell's funeral. We noticed that we're running out of seating, and I just wanted to announce that we have some room up front here on the side. So if you would come up forward and seat here, and there's some over here on this side too up front. Feel free to seat there. The audience, please rise.
Please be seated. On behalf of the family, I would like to thank everyone for traveling today and being here with us to celebrate Brian's life. I'm Bishop Scott Hoffman. I have the opportunity to have Brian and Charmelle in my ward and to consider them and call them my personal close friends. The circumstances in which we meet today are sad, but what a glorious tribute to his life to have a full chapel and a full cultural hall with all of you here. Thank you. Thank you for your reverence and your love, your kind thoughts, and reaching out to the family. In advance, I'd like to thank Brother John Peterson for providing our organ music today, and Brother Wayne Alger as our chorister. Back in the Relief Society room, we've assembled as a family and had a family prayer, which was offered by Brother Justin Buell, Brian's son. We will follow the program as you have outlined on your bulletin. We will begin with an opening hymn found on page 293, Each Life That Touches Ours for Good. Following that, our invocation will be offered by Leah Bone, and we'll move right on to the eulogy by Preston Swayze, and then we'll follow the bulletin from that point on. Brother Wayne.
Thank you. Dear kind Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that we could be here this day, and so grateful for everyone that could come out and celebrate my dad's life. And our dear Heavenly Father, please bless us that the Spirit can be here to comfort those in need and to bring joy to our hearts. And we love thee, and we say these things in the name of my Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I have marks prepared. As I look out on the crowd, I think one of the things I think of most of Brian, and I was talking to someone this outside, just that he touched everyone. Didn't matter where you came from, who you were, who you knew, what class you were in. He came to your level. He loved you. He served you. And he wanted you, most of all, to know that he was your friend. On behalf of the family, I really want to express my appreciation and gratitude for all of your stories and thoughts and kind acts that you've done for us this time. It really does lift us up as we're able to mourn, but also celebrate. And I think if you know Brian, he loved to have fun. And he would like us to be celebrating his life and carrying on all his fun on his behalf. We have a box out in the foyer where we've placed cards for people to share stories, and I do invite you to do that, whether you haven't already done that or if you'll do it after the service. We'd really like to read those stories. As we prepare the remarks today, I just want to touch briefly on Brian's life and then dive into areas that I think are most important and each of us can relate to. Brian Buell was born in Seattle, Washington, to Oris Clifford Buell and Bonnie LaVon Butler Buell on January 4th, 1959. Brian was the third of four boys. His brothers, Mike and Cal, are here with us today. Brian came from humble beginnings. His dad passed away. When he was 12 years old, and his mom worked three part-time jobs to support her four boys, as well as any other children in the neighborhood that were in need. Brian would always recall all the neighborhood boys being at his house for food, to play, place to stay. His mom loved everyone. At 12 years old, Brian also got a paper route. Him and his brother Mike had routes across the street from one another, and they would race one another to see who would finish first. Mike told us that Brian always won. He always had the need for speed. So many of us know Brian in different ways. Some of us knew him as Brian with Boulder Tree Service. Some of us knew him by his nickname Kid when he was playing softball. Some of us knew him as the car guy when he was building, racing, or showing his cars. Some of us knew him as the greeter at church. Some of us knew him as the chainsaw guy who would chase teenagers on Halloween and then ask for pictures. Some of us knew him as Santa. Some of us knew him as the cool grandpa. Some of us knew him as Dad. Hoping to cover a few topics today around those things. Brian at work. When he was around 18 years old, he was inspired by his older brother Cal. He saw that his brother Cal had nice things and made a good living. When Brian asked Cal how he got to where he was, Cal said, "If you want things in life, you have to work hard for them." That was the motto he lived his life by. When we brought this up to Cal, Cal provided a little more color on how Brian got into the tree business. First, he learned to climb and cut trees from Cal. And then Cal had a dream one night that he had a fatal tree accident. And the next day, Cal decided to step away from the tree business. He approached Brian about taking over his business, and Brian agreed. He scribbled out Cal's name on the business cards, and he's been climbing and cutting trees ever since. As we've reflected on his life, I think Brian was quite a quiet adrenaline junkie. He raced cars, worked an extremely dangerous job, and he went skydiving three times. Brian has been in the tree business for 44 years, and he spent the past 26 years running Boulder Tree Service. Hardworking. Brian was an extremely hard worker, and he was extremely strong. Someone told me that Brian was the hardest, toughest, and strongest person in town. I can't argue with that. At 62 years old, Brian could still scale a tree with ease, and he carried heavy saws and logs for extended periods of time. Those who worked for him, no matter their age or their strength, myself included, struggled to keep up with him. He even worked so hard a few summers that he worked himself to heat exhaustion. He forgot that water was important in the desert. Broken bones, lacerations, and broken submerged palm needles were also common injuries. Brian almost lost his arm a number of times to the chainsaw as well. The most recent injury took 100 plus stitches to close up, and Brian was back to work within the week. He would have to have needles cut out of his fingers and arms on a regular basis, and he didn't complain. He broke his arm on two separate occasions, and he cut the cast off himself much earlier than recommended by the doctors. One of them was the day after he got the cast. The other was a couple of weeks. The cast just got in the way of his work. Evening time after work, Brian was a creature of habit. After a long, hard day of work, Brian would always take a nap, and then he would wake up and make bids. After bids, he would come home to watch the 5 o'clock news, followed by a hearty meal. He was a meat and potatoes guy. He especially loved his ribeye. Fun on the job. He always was playing jokes at work. Once he said, "Watch this," you knew you had to pay attention. Certain days he would bring fake spiders and snakes, and then when he was raking, he would throw them at you. He would also on occasion bring firecrackers and tuck them under the chipper. And when you're about to throw things in, he'd blow them up. He always liked to get a nice scare and jump out of you. A tender heart for animals. When removing trees, Brian would always encounter baby birds. He brought those baby birds home, and we would raise them as a family in his bathroom until they were strong enough to fly. Some made it and some didn't. But Brian kept on trying to save those birds. We even adopted a new puppy that Brian met working. He was leaving a job out in Henderson, and a dog was following him down the street. And it kept following him. He opened the truck door, the dog jumped in the truck, and then he sent my mom a picture. She said no, but he brought it home anyway. He then took the dog to work with him for a few days until the new dog got along with the other dogs. Brian named the dog Lucky. Whenever we had food that needed to be tossed in the house, he would go dumpster diving, pull it out of the trash, and then place it in the same spot behind his work trucks. He had to feed his adopted pet rabbits. Generosity to others. Brian was extremely generous when working for others and overall in his everyday life. If he caught wind that someone was in financial need, he would often do their tree work for free. During large windstorms, trees would often go down. And even after a long, hard day at work, he'd fire up the trucks to clear roads and take the trees off of houses. He especially cared for and loved the elderly, and he loved the relationships he built with his customers. Passions and hobbies, cars and softball. Brian found great joy in his hobbies. He had a passion for building, showing, and racing his cars. His first car was a 1956 Chevy, two-door post, as he always emphasized. I think that was a mark of grandeur. I'm not a big car person, but he would always say two-door post, plus 1,000 other words after the car. But he bought it for $250. And that first car set off a string of buying and purchasing and trading. And I think I'd have to estimate he probably had or sold or traded at least 50 cars over the course of his life. He would always be on the lookout for the barn find. A barn find is a car that was stowed away, unused, and sometimes extremely rare. He wanted to hit the jackpot. Many of the cars that he bought ended up being barn finds, but I would call them tree finds. He'd be up in the trees or up in his bucket truck, and he'd notice a nice car that was under a carport or was hidden. And then after a little while, he would approach that person and ask them if they wanted to buy it. He was so persistent that even 10 years later, he would approach the people to potentially try and buy their car. He made sure that his show cars were exceptionally clean, but he was also known for putting on a real show with his cars. He consistently won burnout contests, and if he could make his car disappear in a ball of smoke, you'd be sure to see an ear-to-ear grin on his face afterwards. Brian raced cars for a few years. He built a 1965 Nova, and he joined the 9-second club in the quarter mile. He usually had a car that he was building or an engine that he broke that he needed to fix. Riding with him in his cars was sure to be an experience. He knew how to burn rubber, and he was not afraid to light him up around town. A few streets in Boulder City may still have some skid marks he left behind. He also wasn't shy to pull the e-brake behind people he knew when he would see them walking around town. He would drive up really fast, and then he would just pull it, and you'd hear the, and then Brian would be driving by with just ear-to-ear grin. He loved getting a nice scare, even if it was questionable. Softball. He played softball competitively for 40-plus years, winning tournaments, an All-Star, and MVP awards. His teammates called him Kid, even though he was often one of the oldest on the team. On several of his teams, he was a leadoff batter, and he always played left field. On some of his teams, he was in such good shape that he would also sub in and run the bases for anyone that needed a runner. And he also bought and sold, I'd have to say, 100-plus bats. Brian in the community. Halloween, Santa, service, charity. The Veterans Home. There was a Father's Day car show that was at the Veterans Home for every year, and Brian always made a point to reach out and make friends with the veterans. He had a special place in his heart for the needy or forgotten. He loved meeting residents of the Veterans Home in Boulder City and building relationships with them. At one Father's Day car show, he made friends with two gentlemen, Sid and Joe, and he spent the next five-ish years until they passed away visiting with them a couple times a month. They didn't have family that visited them, and Brian, in true fashion, built a long-lasting relationship with them. He wanted them to feel appreciated and loved, and he took an interest in learning about their lives. In true Brian fashion, he also snuck in milkshakes to them at their request. Church. At church, Brian was the greeter, and he loved giving everyone individual welcomes as he greeted them with a huge smile. This was perfect for him, because he genuinely cared for others and getting to know them. If you know Brian well, he's never late. He'll also leave you at home if you're late. Brian will also fill his pockets with mints and bring them to hand out on Sunday. And that's why we have the mints in the foyer. Halloween. Brian loved, loved, loved Halloween. For Halloween, he had two main costumes. His funny costume would be to dress up as his grandma. He wore a wig, put on lipstick, wore a dress, and used a walker. His scary he also had these crazy teeth he'd put in, and he'd be like, ooh, but that's another thing. He's a kid, kid at heart. His scary costume came natural to him as well, as it involves his preferred tool of choice, a chainsaw. He fired up his chainsaw, spread fake blood all over his clothes, picked his favorite mask, and then he spent the night chasing cars and teenagers. Each year, he'd extend invites to friends to join in on the fun with him. His costume was unforgettable. He scared some and made others cry, but he did it with grace. He also willingly offered to take pictures with them if they were brave enough to stand by him. Although he had the scariest costume, he was always the nice chainsaw guy. Christmas. He also loved Christmas. He wanted people to feel loved around the holidays, and he also wanted to help make Christmas easier for those in need. His brother Mike shared a story with me the other day that one day after work, Brian asked him if he would help out with something. Mike then proceeded to help Brian load his large dually truck with donated goods to take down to the homeless shelter. While there, Brian found a family, and he asked that family to meet him at a store a few days later. And he went through the store with them, buying them the things that they needed for Christmas. Brian would also choose a few nights in December and go out to Walmart off of Sunset, where he would find families in need and slip them cash to make Christmas easier for them. In addition to generosity, his generosity around Christmas, Brian loves spending his weeknights and weekends dressing up as Santa. His grandpa played Santa growing up. And this was always a dream of his. So much so that he bought himself a nice Santa suit. And every year he would ride on the train here in Boulder City. It became popular, and people started asking him to come to parties, and he would gladly accept. He loved taking pictures with everyone. Most special of all, he played Santa for his family. Before I conclude, I just want to call out a few symbols of Brian's life that we have scattered around today. On his casket, we were preparing for the funeral. It was a team effort. All 7 kids, 21 grandkids had input. We got together, we talked through what he would want. We made some jokes in Brian fashion. It taught us to have fun. On the casket, we've added racing stripes as a symbol of him having the need for speed. On the flowers, we have pine cones to represent the trees. And in the foyer, you've seen pictures of the Santa and the mints that he would hand out every Sunday to brighten up people's day. Brian was a kid at heart. He loved playing pranks, scaring others. I missed one. He also had the handlebar mustache. You'll see a few of us have that. Brian was a kid at heart. He loved playing pranks, scaring others, and having a good laugh. He was simple, generous, honest, and hardworking. He cared deeply for others, and he went out of his way to look after those who were in need. He was a loyal and forgiving friend. He liked to see the best in others. He lived his life to the fullest, and most of all, he loved his family. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm gonna read this so I can get through this. My dad. Picking one memory out of a lifetime of wonderful moments and experiences is no easy task. My life was filled with many happy times and adventures thanks to my dad. I could go on forever about all of the amazing things he showed me, the trips, the laughs, and funny stories. But instead, I will focus on how I saw him through the eyes of a child. So long ago, I remember my dad lacing his tall leather climbing boots up the hooks that seemed to go on forever. He would take me to work with him, and I would watch in awe as he climbed to the top of giant trees, using chainsaws to drop massive trunks with precision. They would land with a mighty thud that shook the ground, sounding like a thunderclap. He always reminded me of an action hero from one of the movies he loved to watch. He smelled of pine trees and fresh wood chips. The muscle cars he drove also smelled of leather and pine from the tree-shaped air fresheners he hung so carefully, because his cars were always immaculate. They were loud and ferocious. Some of them had fat tires. Others had roll cages and fancy chrome with tanks instead of back seats. All of them had big engines, and all of them went fast. One in particular had a bumper sticker on it that read, "Get in, sit down, shut up, and hold on." I could remember my dad tying up his cleats before a game, stepping up to the plate, and drilling softballs across the entire field and out of the park. He could catch a ball that seemed to come from miles up in the air effortlessly. He took me on ferry boats to see his mother, my grandmother, whom we both adored. She spoiled him by baking his favorite blonde brownies, and we'd head over to the game farm to feed enormous drooly animal heads loaves of bread through her car windows. We would all laugh, Grandma Bonnie with her sweet cartoony laugh and Dad's classic laugh we all know and love. Being up high gives a unique perspective. From the top deck of the ferry, he would point out the tops of the jellyfish floating on the water. When he took me up on his lift truck, it felt like I could see forever. We parasailed, he, Leah, and I tethered together, watching the horizon and the waves below. He took me when he did a job at a house overlooking the Puget Sound. Even as a child, I was amazed at how beautiful the view was from their backyard. I can only imagine what it looked like from his perspective, high in the treetops. How wonderful it must have been. I imagine what his view is from where he is now. How incredible it must be, him smiling down, wishing he could show us, wishing we could all see. From frosty glasses, a root beer floats at car shows, drawings and letters of mountains with trees and stick figures with spiky hair, bringing home tiny baby birds he entrusted to my care, teaching me to drive a stick shift, walking me down the aisle at my wedding to proudly holding my precious babies. He was there. He fought for me. He made me feel safe. I felt his love, and I love him so much in return. I'm proud of him and his success in life. He showed me anything is possible. I was really blessed having such an amazing dad. I am so glad that my children grew up with him in their lives, and I'm lucky to be able to tell my children and know that they will believe me when I say that no doubt their grandpa was a real life superhero.
I don't know why I had to go on after this song and after my wife. Gosh, it's gonna be hard. There's just really like no way for me to fit all my memories in with Brian in this short time. I can say that it honestly was always a blast. He always wanted to have fun, and it was always happy times. One time while on vacation with Brian and Charmel, we were looking for a place to park down on the beach. The beach was pretty crowded, and Brian had hit a bump and bottomed out the car, and it just made a terrible noise, and everyone on the beach just turned and looked. And in typical Brian fashion, he didn't hesitate. He rolled the window down and said, "Don't worry, it's a rental." Another time, I probably should have threw out a warning and had anybody in the car rental business cover their ears, because there's quite a few of these. Another time, we were on a trip to Washington, and I think it was Devin that came up with the idea. I don't remember, but somehow the idea came up to put fast food trays under the back tires of this van. So we went and got these fast food trays, pulled into an abandoned parking lot, and just started doing donuts in this van. And it was hilarious. Brian finally got done with that and pulled off and said, look at the trays, and they're just sitting there smoking. And so we go and jump on the freeway after that, and I don't know if like the trays had melted or the tire just flattened out, but that thing was like, he's like, "Oh, it'll wear off, it's fine." We live in Utah, so we would, you know, come down to this area two or three times a year to visit, and something that always stood out to me is I'd be sitting in the living room and Brian go, "Come on, Kevin, come here." And he'd take me out in the garage, and he has his cabinet in his garage, and every time, without fail, he always had something in the cabinet for me or the kids that he picked up at a car show or one of his events, and it just made you feel special that he was always thinking of you. Another time, he said, "Come here, Kevin," and he would take me for rides in his cars, but this particular time it was in the Nova. And I'm gonna leave some of this story out, but anyway, he ended up blowing the head gasket on the Nova, which anybody, including myself, would be furious about because of the money and time and headache, but not Brian. We took a picture shortly after getting the car pushed back to the trailer, and he was just all smiles. Just all smiles. And then I saved the greatest story for last. It's the story of when we met, when I was dating Sarah. We were fairly young, and we'd been dating for probably about a year. I didn't know Brian then, because he lived in Washington, we live in Utah. And she would show me pictures of him and tell me stories about him. And some of the stories, she would say that he might have a temper. So I was terrified of him. But in one of the pictures, it was him and her, and I believe it was a yellow 32 Ford. So she went to go visit him, and we had a little bit of a argument before she went to go visit him, and so we weren't like happy with each other, and if I remember right, I don't think we were speaking at the time. And some time had went by. I worked at a fast food restaurant, and I guess he was moving to Vegas at that time, and I'm sitting there at work in Utah, and I see this truck and trailer pull in, and here's this 32 Ford car, and I'm like, "Oh my gosh, he has come here to kick my butt." But I was so nervous, so nervous. But that's not what he did. He came in, shook my hand, told me he was glad to meet me. And I'm just comforted at this moment now, because I know that we will get to have that meeting again one day.
I too had to write down my thoughts. It's really overwhelming seeing how many people are here. Like, that's so cool. I'm gonna start with, it's just a verse from a church song. It just says, "A voice has spoken from the dust, its message pure without alloy, of treasured hope and sacred trust. All men are, that they might have joy. Should sorrow come, we'll not despair, for he would not that men should pine. The grief that comes, we'll learn to bear. Until again the sun does shine before the Lord, then humbly go. His message will our spirit buoy, on us his blessing will bestow, for men are that they might have joy." When I think of my dad, I think of that because my dad always made everything fun. We called him the Disneyland dad. If we had problems, we went to my mom, but if we wanted to have fun, we went to my dad. We are right now in a time of grief, but as I think of memories of my dad in those moments, I can feel joy. I can't find one memory that will do it justice with what I feel for my dad. So I'm just gonna share some things that when I think of, they make me happy and they make me think of my dad. So the smell of fresh cut grass from taking rides on the lawnmower with him. In Washington, we had a huge grass property, so it wasn't just pushing a lawnmower, it was one you actually got a ride on. And he'd always take us for rides on the lawnmower. The sound of a revved engine while watching him do burnouts in car show competitions. The smell of wood chips when he's on a tree job. The taste of fresh scooped root beer floats. The sound of a baseball as it connects with a bat, watching my dad play in numerous softball tournaments. Seeing a pair of fresh new Vans, because my dad always had a new pair of shoes on, and the ones he had, he always kept pristine. If they had any mark on them, it was throw them out, get a new pair. Even to this day, I can't let my kids go out of the house with dirty shoes because of my dad. I'll never be able to look at Santa the same. My dad was the least looking Santa you can imagine, but he loved to play the part. The smell of pepperoni sticks and licorice. Halloween will always remind me of my dad, either being an old lady or dressing up as something super scary with a chainsaw. My friend gave me a picture frame the other day and it said, when a person becomes a memory, those memories will become a treasure. I'll use these memories to fill my grief right now and bring them joy. I see these things, it's crazy. Amen.
I just want to share a few memories of my dad. I always remember going over to my dad's house, and every weekend, he is a man of exactness. Does the same thing every weekend. We'd go either to Sunset Station, Texas Station, go to the buffet. That way no one can complain because we can all choose what we want. We would rent a movie. We'd go to Albertsons. He'd get his bag of Ruffles, can of bean dip, and he'd go and do the hand-scooped candy of the Neapolitan ice cream, and he'd just sit there. And then every time without fail, he'd say, "Take your shoes off, stay for a while," every time I'd come in the house. And those memories will always stick with me, as he didn't like change. He liked to be the same all the time, and you always knew what to expect from him. If you're on good behavior, it was always good times, and I will forever love my dad and the memories that he has left with me.
I'm just going to read a few memories as well. Something came to me this morning and I was thinking about the missionaries and how they used to come over and Anytime there was a new missionary, Brian would always go get his Billy Bob teeth and his glasses, and he would pretend like that was his real teeth, and he would mess with them. And then he would tell him, of course, just kidding, you know. It was funny. So, as you've heard and as you've seen out front, Brian and my mom played Santa and Mrs. Claus on the train, and I was able to be an elf, and I would go walk with them down the train, and it was such an awesome experience watching him interact with the children. He would always have a story about one child who stood out to him. He loved to peek out the windows while the train was loading or unloading and either say, ho, 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 or he'd say, psst, and just make sure it was known to try to get the attention of any child he could. He played Santa for our family events, and he would even swing by our home in his suit and surprise Nobly and Scarlet. He played in the toy kitchen with them, and they called him Papa Claus. Lastly, I wish I could play the video for you all because it's better to watch the video, but I was going through my phone looking at pictures and photos and videos, and Brian went to the dump all the time to dump his wood, and he found this big stuffed animal, one of those really, really big stuffed animals, and he cut holes out in the ice. He pulled all the stuffing out, and he cut the legs off, and he climbed in. And he went into the plastic playhouse, and he just sat there clapping and waving at Nobly and Scarlet, and they wanted nothing to do with the big scary bear. So my mom grabbed Nobly. We kind of tortured her because obviously she wanted nothing to do with the bear. And we sat down, and he just kind of waved and kind of reached for her and grabbed her, and she didn't like that. But then, if you know his laugh, he finally grabbed the head and he pulled it down and he stuck his tongue out and he said, ha, 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 ha. It was the funniest thing, but the saddest thing to watch. And, anyways, so then Nobly was able to run up to him and give him the big hug, and it was her papa. Brian was my second dad. I mean, he was my dad, but he was my bonus dad since I was 8 years old. And while anytime I referred to Brian, I always called him Brian, he was my dad. And I hope he knows how thankful and grateful I am for him and everything he did for me and my family, my mom. I'm so thankful for my 5 bonus siblings and all of the cousins that my daughters have. Brian's humor will be missed. And I'm so thankful that families are forever.
Thank you, Natasha. I wonder if that's the last. I don't have a list of speakers. No. Hello. Thank you all for coming. Brian, I remember when I first met you, it was a pretty intimidating moment. Natasha warned me, and I was like, whatever. Can't be that bad. I shook the guy's hand. I was like, okay, let's not mess this up. So, I remember how fast you welcomed me into your life. Brian literally did everything fast. I remember hearing a lot of your life stories about 3 to 5 times each. I could predict the ending. On some of them at times. I'd heard it before, and I'm like, yeah, crazy. You gave him the attention and respect, and I remember all of them. I remember the countless times you and Charmel provided my wife and I with dinner. I remember all the handshakes. We shook hands all these years when we greeted each other and when we left each other. It could just be hanging out at the house. For some reason, we just always shook hands. We had that respect for each other. I remember your grip well and thoroughly and enjoyed that bond we had. I remember the nickname you gave me. You would call me Ichimon all the time. I would get to work with you, and I have sensitive skin apparently, and I didn't know that, but
I'd work with Brian, and at the end of a shift, my arms would just be bright red with scratch marks on them. And he'd call me Ichiban probably 15, 16 times that day. And every time he saw me after that. I remember playing softball together and you teaching me some things. You'd always give me the time. And always pointing out the guys that don't belong in this league. We'd be playing with him, we'd be co-ed or some junior level, and we'd be playing softball. And Brian would never fail to point out the guys that just don't belong here. They're too good, is what it would be, the guys that were too good. They're smacking home runs, and he'd be like, this guy don't belong here. You know that's Brian, so. He'd tell me it 5 times. Like, yep, I know. I remember how caring you were for my children and how much you loved them. You were never too tired after a hard working day to get down and play with them. I remember your childlike energy. I admire that and always will. Kind of like the story about the bear. I remember getting annoyed when Brian would go too far with teasing my daughters. It would just sit in my head like, man, you are just tormenting my kids, man. You would always stop shortly after I started feeling that way. But I realized that you were just having fun and trying to give my girls attention and fun for them. You're amazing, Brian. I remember a lot of things. You've helped me and my family out so much, Brian. I'm going to miss you so much. Rest in paradise.
Many of you probably just saw Reese and I. She had to go potty, but she opened the doors. She ran to the life-size picture of Charmelle and Brian and said, there he is, my papa, he's Santa. And it was almost like she was just kneeling near his feet. She wanted to hug him. It's been hard to explain to somebody so small that has been around him so much that he's gone, but she has said some very tender things and special things just today. She said, Mom and Dad, do you remember? She said, who's going to put my animals on top of the fan and throw them off? Because Brian would always put her stuffed animals on the top of the fan, turn the fan on, and their animals would start flying around the room. It was one of his favorite things to do with the grandkids. And Preston and I just laughed. We both said, did you tell her to say that? And these are just things that she's remembering. And she wanted to bring today, can you show him your birdhouse? This is a birdhouse that Reese and her papa Brian made about 3 weeks ago. We were up in St. George, and Brian was very insistent that he and Charmelle buy these birdhouses. And he painted them with the grandkids, and we went on a hike, and they put their birdhouses in the trees. And one of the last pictures I have of Reese and Papa Brian together is them with their birdhouses. And then Reese took hers and brought it home, and Brian was a little sad. But we're happy now because it hangs at our house as a reminder of that special memory that they had together. I've known Brian living in this community, but as a father-in-law for almost 7 years, and have had many fun memories, just like so many of you. Charmelle and I walk almost every day. I'm sure many of you have seen us around town. And we never knew when Brian was gonna come up and pretend like he'd honk his horn, he'd skid the tires, Charmelle and I'd be screaming. He'd always call her, where are you guys walking at? And she'd be like, is he coming? So he would always surprise us on our walks. Another funny memory with Reese and Papa Brian, this was just a couple weeks ago at Halloween, he dressed up in his grandma costume, and we drove an hour to a trunk or treat. And he was in character the entire drive, and Reese kept saying, we need to go pick up Papa Brian, where is he? And we explained to him, or to her, that this is Papa Brian. And she was like, oh, okay. So we did the whole trunk or treat for 2 hours. We get back to the car, he takes the wig off, and she goes, oh, there you are, Papa Brian. And Charmelle and I looked at each other, did she just figure this out?
But I'm grateful for so many tender memories, and I'm gonna miss seeing Brian. I'm grateful that we had the opportunity to stay with Sharmell and Brian in their home for the last week of his life, and we were able to share family dinners together, and I will treasure that week of his life that we got to be with him at the very end.
I know you've heard enough of me, but I have just one story that it's just a thing we did together when I was a little kid. First off, I guess the first day I met Brian, I was 5 years old and I kicked a giant hole in the door. He still married my mom. So, very grateful for that. When I got a little older, Brian and my mom, they bought a basketball hoop and they put it in the backyard. And as we talked about, Brian was a creature of habit. He loved barbecue, and he would barbecue 5 to 7 days a week after he got off work. And when I was a kid, I would go outside and I would challenge him to horse. I think we played horse for probably five years. And he beat me every single time. And I was like, Brian, I'm gonna beat you. He's like, no, he beat me every single time. And he always did the granny shot. He put the ball between his legs, he bent over, and he threw it into the hoop. And then I got better, and he would never play me again. even to this day, I was like, Brian, let's play. It's just amazing to me that he was able to work all day long, and then he would get home and he would play softball, or he would play basketball, or he would go help people. And going to work for him as a son, you just wanted to work harder. You wanted to be better, and you wanted to accomplish more. And those are lessons that I've learned from him, and I attribute my resilience, my work ethic, generosity, and love for others, in large part to him. And thank you again for all coming.
Preston had called me earlier to ask me if I was gonna talk today, and I told him that no, I probably wasn't, because I was sure that I wasn't even gonna make it in here. But I didn't need to think about what my favorite memories with Dad were. Because today he taught me. I've been closer with my dad over the last few days and the last week than I feel like I ever have. And he really truly has taught me. We were walking up the street just now. I brought a friend with me. It took a lot for me to get here. It really did. It took a lot. And when I walked up the street, when we first pulled in town, he saw like a motorcycle or something, and he's like, oh, your dad probably would have liked that. I said, you know, because he doesn't know my dad. I said, you know, you're about to see what my dad was all about, and you're about to see what he cherished. And as we walked up the street and saw all the cars, you know, I said, look back. You see it? And then I stood there when I reached Dad's car, and I was stopped. And I got in the passenger seat, and I sat there still listening as my dad told me, now you can see what I cherished as I was sitting in the passenger seat. Dad was a family man, and he did love us. He loved his family very, very much. He had his own way of expressing it, for sure, and he had his own limitations. But he really was love, and that's what he wants from all of us. God is our strength through Jesus Christ and his atonement. And he's further in the work, here and now. I love you, Dad. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you. I, on behalf of our family,
want to thank you for coming today to celebrate the life of Brian Buell. All the love and support that you have shown us to our family has been much appreciated. I want you to know that he loved everyone that's here, plus tenfold of people. He always served, he always gave, and he always wanted to help another person. We truly have lost an awesome brother, husband, father, grandpa, papa, uncle, and friend. Dad loves you guys. He loves you more than ever. I too had to write my thoughts down. I do know our time was cut short with him, but our lives will last forever, and I will hold them dear to my heart. We met 23 years ago at a church dance in Seattle. And he always tells everybody he went to a funeral and came home with a wife. We married, got engaged 3 weeks, married 2 months later. And that is why I had Matt sing that song, The Dance, because that held close to my heart. Because if we didn't have that dance, I wouldn't be here today. A few of my memories of Brian was he loved car shows. The kids have expressed that. He loved burnouts. He loved loud engine contests. He loved anything with the cars, just anything. And by the way, I did do a burnout on the way over here. He always tried to get me to do it, and I couldn't do it. And I did too. So I was driving the Camaro. So he loved cars. He loved cars. He had many cars. And a bunch of the car guys are here today. He also loved softball, as you've heard. He loved softball. 3 weeks before he passed, he was up in St. George for like a Monday, a Wednesday, and a Thursday for one tournament. And then the next week, we were up there Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, and Saturday and Sunday for the next tournament. The first tournament that he was in, they won gold. And he got a gold pendant for that. The next week, he didn't. But you know what? It was a blessing because we were able to spend 3 days together. We painted rocks. We painted birdhouses. We went on hikes. We just spent time together as a family. He loved painting with the grandkids. Pine cones, sparkles, pine cones, wood things, birdhouses, any wood. He loved the paint. And we have tons of paint at home, so we will definitely be using that more. A few years ago, I want to say it was Doug Broadbent asked Brian if he wanted to play Santa at the Christmas train here in Boulder City, and said, oh, I don't know if Brian will do that. I don't know. Eventually he did, and he didn't want to stop. He wanted to do it as much as possible. And when he got done doing that, he was soaking wet. But you know what? He loved the sparkle in the little kids' eyes. He loved to see their happiness when they saw Santa. It meant the world to him. And yes, we did go and buy an expensive Santa suit just for him and a Mrs. Claus suit for me. So we had our own so we could go and help and share that love with others around us. He also, like Preston discussed, he went to Walmart and handed out money to people that he thought might need money at the Christmas time. And he wouldn't just go that person or that person. He really put a lot of thought into it of who really might need that money. And it made him happy to be able to share that with others. I have so many memories trying to put him into one. He used to bring the lift truck home and he would hook a swing on the bucket and he'd lift the bucket up and put the kids in the swing and the kids would just swing back and forth and they loved it. I was afraid they were gonna fall out. They didn't, but he loved it. He had a heart of gold. He would give the shirt off of his back for you. He hired employees that needed a job even though we didn't need them. They needed us and that's what he did. He shared his love with others. He gave his time for others. He even trimmed trees for free because of people that didn't have the money to pay for it. We took several trips to Hawaii to feed the fish. Nobody brought up this one, but Brian, you know Brian, jokester Brian, he would put goldfish, it says, at Hanama Bay, do not feed the fish. And he put goldfish in his pocket, so when you get in the water, the goldfish gets mushy. And it goes out, well then the fish come in, and the people are screaming because the fish are coming in. And he would do that several times when we would go to Hawaii. I'll pick on Brittany and Natasha. When we went to Hawaii 1 year, we buried the girls in the sand. The boys did, not me. And then they couldn't get out of the sand. Well, then they put like breadcrumbs around their faces. Brittany and Natasha couldn't do it. Was it French fries? It was food, and they were screaming, and they couldn't get out of the sand. That's the kind of clown he was. He always liked to have a good time. We went to Australia, had a really special trip to Australia, and he got to feed the kangaroos. We went on several cruises. We went to Disneyland. 1 year we went to Disneyland, and we told the kids we were going to go. It was Sarah's kids, and they came down from Utah, and the kids thought we were going to Hoover Dam. Well, this dam was really long because, as you know, Disneyland was like 4 hours away. And they're like, are we going to get there? Are we going to get there? And we finally got there. And they were so excited that we were at Disneyland and not Hoover Dam. Hoover Dam. I surprised Brian a couple months ago for Father's Day. We went up to Seattle. And you know, we left here because it was hot. And I hated to leave when it was hot because I always worried about Brian when we got back. But we got up to Seattle, and it was a heat, the hottest ever Seattle has ever been. And it was really moist. It was unbearable. But you know what? Brian and Devin were able to take down a huge tree together. And that was a big thud. That was a big thud. But what an experience that Dad got to teach you to do trees. And he does that up there in Seattle, not on, as a job, but as a hobby on his side. I have very many, many, lots of memories with Brian, and I'm sure you guys all do too. I want to close by reading. It's called The Dash Between. I knelt there at the headstone of the one I love and cried. Name with dates of birth and death were perfectly inscribed. I pondered these two dates and how little they both mean when compared to the tiny dash that lies there in between. The dash serves as an emblem of our time here on Earth. And although small, it stands for all our years of life and worth. And our worth will be determined by how we live each day. We can fill our dash with goodness or waste our life away. To ourselves as well as others, let's be honest, kind, and true. And every day live the way we know God wants us to. May we look for opportunities to do a worthy deed and reach out with compassion to those who are in need. For if our hearts are full of love throughout our journey here, we'll be loved by all who know us, and our memory they'll hold dear. And when we die, these memories will bring grateful, loving tears to all those lives were touched by the dash between our years. I pray that we all remember the time in between each one of our dashes, and that we know that we can make an impact and touch the lives that come in between those dashes. Because Brian has touched so many lives. He was a wonderful man, a wonderful father, and a wonderful husband, and he truly missed by so many. Thank you, Brian, for loving us. Until we meet again, always and forever, I love you.
Brian packed a lot of living in his dash, Charmel. Between January 4th, 1959, dash, November 7th, 2021. What a life. I just want to say thank you again on behalf of the family for being here. Thank you for all of you who participated, and for Brother Matt singing that beautiful number. It was lovely. They say a good funeral service is over in an hour, and so we're just a little bit past that, so I don't have much to say other than one thing. As all of you, I loved Brian Buell. Loved him with all my heart and would have done anything for him. And I know that Brother Brian Buell loved me as he loves each and every one of you. There's no doubt. And what thing is there greater than love? Savior Jesus Christ told us that was all that really matters. And today is a wonderful outpouring of that. So thank you all. We will conclude our service by singing God Be With You Till We Meet Again on page 152, and our benediction will be offered by Kelsey Buell. Following that, we'll ask everybody to stand as Brother Tyson Smith exits the chapel with the casket.
in heaven. Thank you for the incredible privilege it was to know one of your most beloved sons, Brian Buell. We will forever be grateful of his example of true love, seeing people the way you see them, kindness, graciousness, and just everything he was, joy. Heavenly Father, please wrap your arms around us at this time as we mourn the loss of such a wonderful man. Please give us peace that only you can provide when times are hard. Please allow us to remember the example of Brian and allow us to give love to others the way that he did. We love thee so very much, and we're grateful for every moment that we had with Brian, and I pray that we are able to remember each one as a treasure, and I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
All, please rise.
So what's the shield on there?